Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the International 5 Qualifiers. We're live with Team America.
Yeah! I've been in Germany too long, man. Cast with some Americans. I got an Englishman in the office. I got a Australian.
Even the phone numbers are worse, you know?
We're
a little gripe session about it. They got all these extra digits.
It's every no single good. Time I go back to America, I'm just like, I just realize how many things I missed. And I'm just like, things are open 24/7. Look how many food options I have. I can get fresh.
You can have something besides just bratwurst for a meal.
No offense to the
Europeans, probably majority of whom are the viewers. We still love you guys.
Watching the European qualifier,
But we have a best of two coming up now. We are going to see London Conspiracy in their second series. They got done with an impressive 2-0 dismantling earlier today of Na'Vi, who, be fair, did not look prepared. Honestly, looked like they had not done any research on London Conspiracy, did not ban their key heroes, and got punished. Still, LC looks strong, Cap, and, well, they're going to be facing Yellow Submarine, a team that has yet to play a game in the qualifiers.
Yeah, I actually, real quickly, we have on screen Madara. I think that I've actually had an opportunity to cast quite a bit of London Conspiracy because they went through our, like, Gigabyte challenges and joined Dota League and those sort of things, so I've gotten a chance to see them in action, and if you came into this qualifier thinking, okay, that's one of the teams that I don't really have to study at all, you are completely wrong. London Conspiracy were my favorites to provide the most upsets in this whole entire group. I think they are actually the biggest determining factor in where the teams end up. Not necessarily that they'll make top one or two, but because of the punishment of getting ties or even losses as opposed to wins, which are worth so much, I think that London Conspiracy, the upsets they provide, are actually going to determine the top two.
So you basically view them as like they're the spoilers of the group.
Basically.
If
they
nothing
really
else.
Are.
I mean, hey, they start 2-0. The way that this format works, you get... If they can get one more 2-0 win, they have an extremely good chance to advance. Because at that point, you have 6 points. And maybe you need to tie one more game. But I think at that point, you're mathematically at least going to be in a tiebreaker, if not automatically into the next round. And, well, with that said, Yellow Submarine, the draft has begun. And they were very quick to react here. London Conspiracy, first pick Queen of Pain. Bans look very standard for this version. Occasionally, we do see the Wisp ban first phase, especially in Europe, but not the case here. Yellow Submarine, insta-pick Wisp, Spiritbreaker. It's like they didn't even hesitate for half a second. And we see London Conspiracy go for the Winter Wyvern here, something that I guess is pretty good against Wisp in general. Hero that tends to clump up with its partner. You can get off the curse and potentially have the carry just blowing up the Wisp at the start of a fight.
I think it's a huge counter just because of the fact that when you're able to put Winter's Curse on the Wisp and have his partner take out the Wisp right away.
And
like,
it's normally like
it's
a mega
so
carry.
Huge. Yeah.
It's like a Bristle or a Sven or Tiny, someone that just can 3 or 4 shot the Wisp potentially.
Yeah. So, and then I also think that the Wyvern pickup is really good against the Spiritbreaker as well. Spiritbreaker is actually a hero that London Conspiracy like to run quite a bit. London Conspiracy's general style is actually very open. They're actually probably one of the teams that is, I would say, the most unique when it comes to their play style. For example, they love running the four-position Kunkka. Now, that's actually something Yellow Submarine have in common. They have done this before, but it's much more likely London Conspiracy do something like that, and we saw it in the game against Na'Vi do quite well in that game number two. So.
Yeah, I was hoping to get to see the Invoker again, but I suppose for London Conspiracy, it's kind of a risky strategy going for that like Sunstrike lineup. If they see it coming and they get a really strong defensive support, like be it an Abaddon or a Dazzle, or they're just prepared for it and pick difficult to burst heroes, then the whole thing can fall apart. So
the fact that London Conspiracy know quite a bit about how to run Spiritbreaker, they know some of the best counters, and I think Winter Wyvern is definitely one of the best ones out there because Spiritbreaker is all about focusing down one target, and it's all physical damage. So, like, if you're able to get that Cold Embrace in there, and basically
whoever he
save
goes
that
on
target, you're good.
I mean, the bash is magic, but outside of that, it's pretty much all physical.
Most likely, you're going to be able to survive through the bit of magic that comes out, and you're going to be disabled during that period of time anyway, so the Cold Embrace doesn't harm you in any way with the four-second stun, essentially. It's going to be able to keep you alive. It's like the Spirit Breaker's whole entire combo that he just used didn't do anything because the heal is going to outdo the damage, and the four-second stun is pretty much taken over by Cold Embrace. So I think it's a very much a direct counter here. Yellow Submarine, though, are going to go for the SF. A favorite for them for sure. This is most definitely one of their most commonly picked up carries. So they have Mapochka, who I pointed out to the production that I really felt like he was one of the players to watch for Yellow Submarine. I was really impressed by his performance in previous matches. This is not going to be his hero, though. While Mapochka is usually centered up in the mid lane, he only plays the type of heroes that are able to make a lot of space going into the mid game, and this will usually fall down on their actual carry player, which I believe is Fervian.
Okay. Well,
no, it's Barish. I'm sorry.
It's Barish. Gotcha.
Okay. So yeah, but they usually take over like the one. They split the one and two role. It just kind of depends on what's actually being run mid here. The SF being obviously more of a carry style mid than a playmaker means that we're probably going to see something a little bit more aggressive in the safe lane for Mapochka to take over.
Well, London Conspiracy, they go into a Bristleback now, a very difficult to kill core. And at this point, they've got Queen of Pain, Bristle, not the easiest heroes to gank. Yellow Submarine have Charge, Nether Strike, but there's the Winter Wyvern to keep them alive, which you'd already talked about. And both of these heroes are very mobile slash tanky, respectively, in general. So they started with Spiritbreaker, and that looks like heavy gank, but now they back off into a Shadow Fiend. And seeing these picks, I think Yellow Submarine may just want to adjust their game plan, because if it's all about finding kills early, I feel that's a very low percentage way to approach this draft.
Yeah, I felt like London Conspiracy, when I was watching them in like Gigabyte Challenges and stuff like that, I felt one of their biggest strengths was the dynamic playstyle that they had that allowed them to be able to pick up many different kind of heroes. Gave a big advantage to Spartan when he does drafting, and he gets pretty creative in the drafting, so I felt like they always had an advantage in those games against the teams they were facing. But at the time, they're facing maybe, you know, tier 3, maybe some tier 2 teams in there. And I'm really interested. This is going to be the biggest test for them. Can they actually still get the drafting advantage over these, you know, tier 2 and some even tier 1 teams that are in this qualifier? And from that Na'Vi game, I felt like London Conspiracy did outdraft Na'Vi.
I mean, this is probably their best shot to go 4-0 or to have two 2-0 wins in the group, I would say.
Yeah, and 6 points off the start.
You really have to tank the rest of the way. Mm-hmm. I feel like you win one more game out of your next four and you're moving along, most likely. But here we go. London Conspiracy picking up the Rubick now. Excellent support versus Spiritbreaker. A lot of other good spells to steal. The Raze is great for farming. Mainly Ravage from Tidehunter. The rest is kind of eh. But I think more than anything, just a versatile support that can move around a lot early, scales reasonably well, and is good against the Cow. So Yellow Submarine also kind of adjusted their game plan here. They go back for the Tide, the Shadow Fiend. More emphasis on team fight potential. Maybe looking to push a bit more later on. No real obvious Wisp partner here. And it may just be one of those, we just want to have the flexibility of a Wisp, but we're not going to pick like a classic partner for it.
Yeah, I really think, maybe I'm focusing too much on it, but I really feel that Wyvern is such a good counter to the Wisp that they have to change up their game plan from the first 1-2.
I agree.
Because if you pick up a Tiny, you pick up a Sven, anything like that, the Wyvern's going to lock down the Wisp. You're going to be sucked into that one. It's a huge disadvantage. So I think that I agree with what Yellow Submarine are doing here. I really feel like they have to utilize the Wisp to get them an offlane advantage. So I would actually like to see the Wisp Tidehunter being run there in that top lane. You are looking at the lane of London Conspiracy. Most likely, they're going to be a little bit slow on damage, right? Unless it's like a Queen of Pain safe lane, which gives you a lot of kill potential. I feel like the Wyvern and the Rubick, they do a lot of harassment, but the Wisp heal over time is going to be able to counter that for the most part. And if it's a Bristleback in the safe lane, he's not going to give you a whole lot of kill potential either. It's very slow buildup of damage, right?
So then we're looking at, this makes things interesting. They pick up the Sniper, a hero that can dominate one. He's not really been picked at all in this patch. Ever since the nerfs that came around with 6.84, Sniper's kind of fallen by the wayside, but he does give them some additional long-range burst damage. Can synergize reasonably well with Relocate, but where I really like him is he's got Spiritbreaker and Tide on the same team. So he's got the frontliners. Now you have the Sniper who can sit back. There's no great heroes to jump him, really.
My God, the constant pickups from both of these teams that are so interesting. There's such a tie between the two of them, right? I was like, Yellow Submarine, didn't they recently run a Sniper? No, that was actually London Conspiracy who ran a Sniper recently.
Right before
this
tournament.
Who runs Sniper right now? You know, it's like in 6.84, not many teams
are
really experimenting.
I saw one team run it, which was Summer's Rift against, I think it was a Shadow Shaman because they thought it was really good. Or no, it was against an Undying because he has long range, so he's pretty good at killing the Tombstone was the idea. But even then, the hero lost anyway. So it just feels like he doesn't have quite the impact he did in the previous version. Just doesn't, like, some of the items that he was were really strong got nerfed a little bit. The heroes got weaker. And more importantly, it just feels like a lot of these items that encourage, like, frontline tanks, like, have been introduced to the game. The Solar Crest is a big one. Just in general, games are laning stages breaking down sooner. And Sniper's just not allowed to sit back and play a 1v1 matchup in the mid lane too much.
Yeah, and the heroes he's facing up against, Queen of Pain, Bristleback, the Zeus to a certain extent, are all big threats to the Sniper. The Queen of Pain and Bristleback are able to get on top of the Sniper pretty quickly, which is a huge factor. And the Zeus has that ultimate to throw down at any time. So if they just get on top of the Sniper, the Zeus adds the extra damage. This could be a very quick kill on the Sniper, and then they could go ahead and turn onto the SF from there. But if they do manage to just win the laning phase really hard with this pickup, I think that's the best shot the Yellow Submar1ne have to be able to win with the lineup they have. I still am going to lead quite heavily to London Conspiracy in their draft. I feel like it's just a more safer all-around draft that is going to be able to win on multiple stages of the game. I think they can win the laning phase. I think they most definitely should be able to win the early, like, 15 to 25 minute marker kind of period with the Queen of Pain and the Zeus just outputting so much magic damage together. And if they snowball that, I think the Bristleback then takes over the mid game quite heavily. And if this goes late, then I feel Yellow Submar1ne will definitely take it. But there's so many opportunities for London Conspiracy to end the game before that point.
Well, with that said, looks like we are waiting for one of the players here to reconnect. Again, guys, London Conspiracy is 2-0 in the group in their first set, which means that they have 3 points already. Yellow Submar1ne yet to play a single game. I'm inclined to agree with you in general. I feel like the big issue for Yellow Submar1ne here is they're very reliant on... I mean, because they can't rely on charge and relocate, given the Wyvern pick, and the one hero they can maybe kill is the Zeus, but that's the hero that you imagine Rubick slash Wyvern are either going to be camping the lane if they expect to gank or even have a TP to quickly rotate in and turn that fight. That's outside of him, you're not killing Bristle unless he really screws up this game in the early stage. Queen of Pain, likely to have an easy time whatever lane she's in. And they have other options, even if the lanes don't go well. They can rely on burst damage pickoffs from their two heavy nukers. The Bristleback can farm stacks pretty easily.
Yeah.
I feel like their supports can almost do whatever they want. They don't have anyone who's a weak laner or who needs a lot of support. Whereas Tidehunter, in the off lane, whether he's against, like, this Queen of Pain, or I guess it's probably the Queen of Pain there and Bristle off lane. So that's a matchup that Tide will have a tough time in 1v1. So he's going to need help from the Wisp, which means the Wisp can't really go support mid as much. And now you've got a Sniper sitting mid all by his lonesome, and someone's got to protect him. Spiritbreaker can't really do it. He can maybe try and charge mid to take some pressure off. But, yeah, in general, I feel like the LC supports have a lot more options as far as what they want to do this game.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree. I mean, both the Rubick and the Wyvern are going to be excellent heroes to rotate into that middle lane to catch out the Sniper, to allow the Zeus to be able to get that first blood. Real quick, I just want to go back here. Do you prefer to see the Bristleback here as a safe laner or the Queen of Pain? Because just off the players right now, they can swap at any time. I thought it was going to be a Bristleback offlane as well. Skylark is their offlaner. The Queen of Pain offlane here, I do not like. In 95% of games that it's a potential pickup, it's just, like, I think terrible. But in this one specific matchup, because you're going to be most likely dealing with either a poor tri-lane in that the Wisp and Spiritbreaker aren't really going to be able to provide a whole lot of harassment power against a very mobile and ranged hero like Queen of Pain. And also, like, and then the other option is it's even just a dual lane with a Spiritbreaker looking to pull and such. I think there's a lot of opportunities for Queen of Pain to actually make the offlane work, despite the fact that I normally do not support offlane Queen of Pain at all.
Yeah, I think they could do it. I guess, to me, you really want the Queen of Pain against the Tide. I feel like that's the ideal laning setup. So if they expect Yellow Submar1ne to dodge or to kind of move around and avoid that matchup, then maybe you predict it, send Queen of Pain offlane. Regardless, I feel like LC have excellent dual lanes, whether it's like a Wyvern Bristleback sounds pretty strong to me. Queen of Pain Rubick's great.
Sure.
I think they could even swap them, although I feel like those are probably the preferred dual lanes. So, yeah, I would like to see LC just shut the Tide down in the laning stage. And to me, Bristle is actually, he's decent at it, but he's not going to be quite as good as what a Queen of Pain
is. Oh, absolutely. The Queen of Pain will be 100% the stronger laner against the Tidehunter. And you're right. That, I mean, the biggest thing is just shutting down the Titan in the laning phase. He doesn't have much to fall back on. He can farm up stacks. He can farm up ancient stacks, potentially, go into the jungle, maybe do some hard camps. But it's much lower than most other offlaners who have a jungling option, right? You have to actually get the levels to be able to farm up an ancient stack. You want at least level 3 or maybe even level 5 to farm up regular stacks. It's just going to be very slow if the Tidehunter doesn't have a good time in the safe lanes. So,
where do you see like the weak points of LC's draft? Because we are talking like we think LC is a stronger draft tier, and even if that's the case, obviously the lineup is not invincible. So like if you're Yellow Submarine, you want to break this lineup down. To me, the one hero that's the easiest to kill is the Zeus. He's also probably their biggest damage dealer.
Yep.
Do you see them trying to get some charge ganks going mid early? Do they just try and turtle and farm stacks with Tidehunter and Shadow Fiend? Like, what's the best game plan here, would you say, for Yellow Submarine?
I really believe that Yellow Submarine's whole entire game here is going to fall on the Spirit Breaker, making enough space for the SF and Sniper to be able to get their farm. If they can actually, like, maybe even get a couple of kills here and there with the Spirit Breaker on the middle lane, or potentially even running down and maybe going to the safe lane and somehow catching them out or something like that. If he can just get one or two kills to open up just a bit, Yellow Submarine do have a lot of farming capabilities. I mean, they have an SF who can get so far ahead of any of the members of London Conspiracy, right? If they just play defensive, they're not feeding away kills, there's no question about it. SF will be able to out-farm Bristleback, Zeus, Queen of Pain, like all of them. He will get a good 2,000, 3,000 net worth ahead of them by 20 minutes easily. Right, so I think that's the biggest advantage that Yellow Submarine has, is the Spirit Breaker factor in the laning phase, making space for the SF to be able to get ahead in net worth in those first 20 minutes, and then the SF develops these team fight items that are going to be capable of allowing them to defend maybe not tier 1 towers, but definitely tier 2 towers. They draw out the game, and London Conspiracy eventually run out of steam.
All right. Well, with that out of the way, Cap, it's our first time casting together in, I think, like 3 years. You and I cast together 2012 when you were working for Absolute Legends. I asked you if I could join you for a game, and you said sure. And I don't think we've cast since, man. So
no.
I'm pumped. I'm excited for this. Let's get into it. London Conspiracy looking for their second 2-0 win. And Yellow Submarine, the folks that stand in their way. A little skirmish early on, but it's a tanky one, the Spirit Breaker in the front lines. And now suddenly the Tidehunter's decided to skill up Gush, and he comes rushing in. All of a sudden, Sawspartan is down. Get the hell out of our jungle, say the Yellow Submarine. And it seems the Beatles fans will prevail here.
London Conspiracy, did they forget the power of Sniper? I mean, that you do not fight into Sniper at level 1. That's just one of the go-tos of 6.83 was Shrapnel was just too strong. You're able to spam out 3 different ones in the beginning. Like,
they were
how
very,
do you fight into that?
And they were going on the Spirit Breaker. If you're going to win a level, this hero has the highest effective HP in the game. It's either him or Ogre, I forget which, but he's basically...
No, it is
him. It is him,
you're
and then
right.
Ogre's right after. So you're not killing him unless you can kill, like, their entire team.
That,
to me, it's crazy they're even trying to go on him. Maybe they didn't anticipate the Gush being skilled early on, which definitely is going to hurt the Tide a bit, but... Oh, actually, it's Tide versus Queen of Pain. So this lane is going to be pretty rough for Dale. I still think it's worth it for Yellow Submarine to get the first blood. The other thing is they didn't let any wards get dropped down now, though. You can see Sawspartan already trying to be cheeky with the body blocks. Bash has been skilled up. He has the boots first, and therefore is just a bit faster than Fervian. But if that's a level 2 cow, he might go down.
Yeah, I mean, they're getting some damage on the Sniper, but I feel like the Spirit Breaker just being that frontline hero, they have to somehow get past him in order to go on the squishy heroes like the Wisp and Sniper. I really don't think this aggro tri-lane is going to work out that well for them. But then again, it doesn't necessarily have to, right? As long as they get the Queen of Pain a really good time in this 1v1 against the Tidehunter, Skylark wins this lane hard enough. It makes up for the fact the aggro tri-lane may not be all that successful at shutting down the Sniper.
The downside is if they... It seems like they're not going to tri-lane. I was going to say the downside is if they just sit in a tri-lane, Shadow Fiend versus Zeus is going to be very easy for the Shadow Fiend. Already you can see 8 souls.
For sure.
Courier might get sniped here, though. Sawspartan, he's trying to wait it around the trees, but guess who's waiting? Rubick, though, may not actually see it walk by. Oh, this is unfortunate for the little guy.
He may still catch it. If Baro shows himself and he sees,
oh, he sees
the bottle.
He sees the bottle in the lane. Is he going to know where it's going? He does, but
he's
just too late, Cap. It's going to make it out.
Oh, no.
The hero. What the hell is this one called? I can't even...
Yeah.
I don't have my magnifying glass.
I was looking at it earlier.
I wanted to use his name. But
it's the Wyvern Hatchling.
Okay. The Wyvern Hatchling. The Red Dragon. Well, actually, I think they're not dragons, but whatever.
That anyway, that's so a bit good. Sad, right? Because Spartan actually could have gone for the gank on the SF instead.
He was low. He was at like around half HP, and he had no mana, so there's no real counterplay potential there.
They take out the bounty rune. Wyvern actually denying it just to make sure he didn't have to get close. A little bit surprised just because he has Arctic Burn, which would allow you to get over the cliffs. But then again, if you get stuck up on that cliff, it's a 50-second cooldown, so you're going to be there for a while.
Yeah, that's no fun for anyone. So far, Dale has picked up his Reign of Regen. We'll see if he actually wants to go into some more regen items here or compete some Tranquil Boots potentially or just ferry out a bottle. But for now, it looks like Sossbarn does want to apply some pressure on the mid lane. He tries to move in, but
actually, this is not going to find.
This is just not an easy kill. With the way Barish is hugging the cliff, doesn't seem like it's going to be possible.
Yeah, if you're going for it, it's got to be, I think, through a smoke gank. I mean, like the way I envisioned with the defensive try lane out, the Wyvern or the Rubick being able to smoke and potentially even go all the way around through the Dire side or just be able to. The Wyvern can actually just go up on the cliff and then pop the Arctic Burn and run down it.
Oh, he is going to make his way in here, though. Oh, never mind. Just wants to poke him a couple of times, but they don't have the level 5 on Zeus yet, and he's gone for the more standard build nowadays seems to be you don't try to get Thunderbolt to level. It used to be most players would get the level 3 Thunderbolt at level 5, but this build is much more about your economy, securing the early last hits. Downside is you don't have as much burst at level 5 to try for a kill. But in any case, he didn't have it regardless.
If you go Arc Lightning, only level 1, every single time your range creep is going to be denied. Like, guaranteed, because you leave it with something like 20 HP.
And your attack, you're just not going to get in there to actually hit it that one last time. Yeah. We do see S224J. Are we going to say that every time? That could get hard, but PSM trying to duke it out with him. In comes the Shadow Fiend. They lift him up, dropped him down. The Zeus has arrived as well. Throws out the Thunderbolt. Kaiser, one more auto attack. They get the counter kill, but it's a two-hero charge coming out. Another Bash Furby and the 17% Master. Is he going to find Sossbarn? No, he can't quite. And now he'll just walk away. Nobody is messing with him. Not this day.
Still managing to kill the SF. So SSJ, I'm not sure why he has that, but I have a better name for you, for him.
Okay.
We call him Skanks.
Skanks. Really?
So hope you enjoy calling him Skanks. Yes.
Is this approved that's by the actually, player, or is this
No, that's actually his name. He actually has the name Skanks. That's what they call him.
Okay.
So.
Well, that works a lot better.
Yeah.
Here's our Queen of Pain. Skylark does have a haste room bottled up. Looks like he may want to go on Dale, and conveniently enough, Dale's... Ooh. Oh, never mind. Okay. Looks like it's going to be perfect for the kill. He's like, no, I'm just going to run the hell away now. He does have a TP, though. I think Skylark, even preferring to save this haste run, hoping he can get, like, 2 or 3 kills bottom rather than committing everything for a potential Tidehunter kill.
Oh, yeah. Since his aggro tri-lane isn't actually winning the lane by any means, they do need to look for that potential upset. The sniper's getting perfectly fine farm. 22-7 compared to the 18-1 on the Bristleback. And I would also say that the sniper is getting a big advantage since he's able to get solo experience sometimes with the Wisp and Spirit Breaker actually rotating out. So the faster he gets his level 6, the heavy amount of pressure he's going to be able to put on Madara and the two supports by just spamming that out once or twice.
Yeah, and the big thing here for LC is their Zeus has level 6 now as well. So you've got a haste bottled Queen of Pain and a Zeus level 6. Yellow Submarine, they want to be playing super defensively for the next minute or so.
What do you think the Queen of Pain's item build for this game is going to be? Is it just a straight Aghanim's? I don't see too much incentive for an Orchid this game.
Orchid's decent against Wisp would be the main thing, but yeah. I feel like Aghs also helps in that regard as well because you just have better burst to try and bring him down. Yeah, I would lean towards... I like Necrobook on Queen of Pain, although I feel like we don't see that many players going for it. It did get a pretty big buff in 6.84. It used to be like Necro 1 and 2 are just garbage items, especially Necro 1. Then Necro 3 was great, but it scales a little bit better now.
Skylark was kind of forced to popping that haste rune and headed over to the middle lane, but Barash, and this is always the difficult thing about an SF, is that he always is playing so passively in lane because he can just go jungle, right? He 1-2 raises up the wave pushes in, he goes back and stacks or maybe clears through some stacks he's
it's
already
set up. It's just a very like easy and natural rhythm, especially once you have some experience playing Shadow Fiend, which Lord knows everyone in the qualifier certainly
they go
does.
Bottom instead.
Here's Queen of Pain waiting in position. They have the ultimate available. Out comes the Zeus ult, the Wyvern keeping Sossbarn alive for ages here. Now he gets off the list. He's going to drop Furby and down for the time being, and Well, Bristleback just happily farming that top lane while this is going on. Skylark going to work, but now the Ravage comes in. They look to turn it. They get one. The second kill is going to come out as Skanks will fall. Kaiser even forced the TP in to try and save this fight. Zaspartan caught within. The bashes continue to pile up, and it ends up being a 1-for-3 exchange so far. Kaiser now getting charged. He could be the fourth man down. He turns. He's going to bolt.
Oh,
and Fervian trying to play the dangerous long con here with the sticks. Ends up coming up short.
Yeah, that was not an ideal play from our Spirit Breaker.
I don't know if we're done yet.
Yeah,
that looks like Kaiser's done as well.
This is just getting nasty, but London Conspiracy really got to get away from this bottom lane. Spartan's dead now. Jesus, this is just a feeding fest at this bottom lane.
What's going on here?
I don't know, but London Conspiracy, I mean, that was a bad fight for them. The Wiz did a really good job keeping everyone alive. PSM has been...
He was not focused at all. He was actually pretty low, but they never prioritized bursting him.
Yeah, they just went in like all in on the sniper, let's go, and then the fight kind of turned really awkward, and they never had an opportunity to target the Wiz from there. Skanks, you gotta get out of here.
I don't know about this. He's gonna be up on the cliff, Assassinate coming through. He's stuck anyway, and he tries to keep himself alive, but raised and dead. This is not the same London Conspiracy.
Oh, Mafoshka's dead, though. Skylark actually managed to jump on him. The Lightning Bolt actually missing there, but Queen of Pain still gets the last hit, so they get something for all their trouble, but it's still Yellow Submarine who are winning the early laning phase, and I would say that's the Spirit Breaker factor. I don't think London Conspiracy are playing very well, especially that fight at bottom with the Wisp doing so much, but the Spirit Breaker is definitely a big part of these early game engagements and is working out quite well for Fervian.
The other thing was I believe Madara had just TP top when that fight broke out because he did not join the fight. Either that or he just didn't have TP gold. But that was a long fight. That was like 30 seconds and he never came to it. So rather unfortunate. That's definitely the kind of engagement you want a Bristleback involved in. Prolonged and especially showing up a bit later on. But when the dust settles, Cap, we're going to see a fast mech on the way for Barash. Already has the buckler and I think more. Yeah, the headdress bottle coming out. So just needs about 500 gold for that mech recipe.
Do you agree with SS still going for mech since the recent nerf to SF, or rather to the mech? I mean, it's so expensive on mana now anyway, but then you have the cooldown increase.
He just farms it so quickly. I feel like that's the thing with SF, is if you want someone else to get it, like let's say Tidehunter would be, oh, they're going on him now. Barash, oh, gets burst a little bit more, lifted, drop back down. He turns with the raises. What a play. Braids down the Rubik, but they're not done yet, Cap. Ravage is available, and Dale wants to chase.
Yeah, Skylark's going to be caught out by that Ravage. Lock him down, Anchor Smash, another kill as they take out the Queen of Pain. And that is so huge, but they're going to keep on going. Skanks might be the next target, but there's no way. Mass TP's in it. If anything, this is going to turn sour for Dale. Oh, the Lightning Bolts. I really thought he was going to be able to hit that one.
And on top of that, stick charges were being held for a long time there.
Yeah.
They lose their precious Shadow Fiend in the end. Is traded for a Queen of Pain. He did not buy the mech recipe yet, though, so it's still late a little bit. Wiz tried for the relocate out, but just ends up bringing Dale back to the lane in the end.
This is such a wand game that literally everyone on Yellow Submarine should have a wand. Even heroes like heroes like Sniper are getting a magic wand as well. You know it's a really good wand game. You've got the spam out from the Zeus as well as the Bristleback.
Oh, they're going to clash here at the bottom side of the map. Almost instantly charge onto Zaspartan. He gets off the lift in the nick of time. Tosses him back. Stuns three. Still seems like he should fall here. No, the Embrace keeping him alive a bit longer. Now Zeus arrives, but so too is the Shadow Friend. Queen of Pain ult coming through. They bring down the Io. The Zeus falling in exchange. And now Skylark being pursued. They managed to plink him down in the end here. Another takedown happening in the pit as Fervian makes it a 1-for-3, and the Tidehunter limps away.
Oh, he almost got Dale? I think he got him. The Urn's got him. Wow, that was such a play from the Rubik, managing to pull out that extra kill. Terrible fight for London Conspiracy,
but
at least Rubik did something.
Yeah, this is not going well, man.
No, I mean, again, they target the Spirit Breaker. Like, why? The first thing Zeus does when he comes to that fight is lightning bolts him. Why?
And then on top of that, they're fighting without the Bristleback. Two big prolonged skirmishes in a row. They're just getting worked. Madara has stick charges here. He's trying to bait with them a bit. He might be able to turn this with support from the Rubik, but Assassinate comes out. Oh, the lift!
Beautiful.
It's going to prevent it. They get two kills. Now the Zeus nuke coming through. And suddenly it's PSM who wants to run away. He does have a tether, but he needs to get out of here quickly. Mech, and now the turn. Well, Zaspartan. He might not make it out.
Yeah, if anything, Kaiser might be able to kill the Wisp with this. Skylar comes in, the couple of right clicks, but he's healing up too much. Skylar's going to fall instead. Oh, dear.
16-9 already. What a clown fest this has become. Now onto Submar1ne.
The relocate out!
Get me out of here. He says he's going to come back with full health. Kaiser, you cannot stick around for this.
Oh, man. That relocate, he was just about to turn in telekinesis, but the Requiem of Souls goes out and immediately disappears. If that relocate didn't happen, and he gets the telekinesis there, the SF is stuck there for a little bit. I think Kaiser kills him as the turnaround, but excellent save. PSM pulling out some plays here. Yellow Submar1ne, I've been very much impressed with both Maposhka and PSM in the past. They were my two players to watch for Yellow Submar1ne, and they're both, I mean, PSM is performing really well here. Maposhka, I mean, it's a sniper game. There's not much brilliant moves you can make with a sniper.
Hey. Sometimes you get lucky in your headshot procs, okay? This is just bloody, man. I was casting China last region, and we had some action-packed games, but this is just the next level. It feels like just pure CIS Dota, to be honest, even though I know technically LC's from Greece, but I think they play enough of these Russian and Ukrainian teams that it just, like, infects your soul or...
I mean, enough of the...
Empowers
like,
you.
Yeah, enough of the Tier 3 teams, right? Like, every single Tier 3 team, their biggest strength is usually the early laning phase.
Yeah.
Right? And when it comes to those kind of fights, because that's what you experience every single game. Not every single game has a strong contested mid game. Not every single game goes to the late game at all,
exactly.
Right? Every single scrim you have, though, has a laning phase. And oftentimes in the Tier 3, Tier 2 area, that's where games are won and lost, right? Is you get enough blood on the battlefield, you're able to stir up that snowball, and you go from there. So this is definitely one of those games, it seems like. London Conspiracy and Yellow Submar1ne are just smashing heads.
Well, we had a pause here. It looks like our sniper Miposhka had to disconnect. I'm just inserting random sounds where I mean, it can't be worse than my attempt at Dutch. Heaver almost killed herself on the spot. But we are waiting for a reconnect here. They had to reboot the internet. It looks like he is back in the game according to the indicators, but they're not ready to unpause yet.
Item-wise, we do have a couple of very important pickups coming up here. To start with, the Tidehunter is about to get his Blink Dagger. Now, we said one of the biggest factors was keeping the Tidehunter very low level and unable to get his Blink Dagger. Well, a Blink Dagger at 13 minutes is a very quick pickup. So Dale's already had a couple of very successful Ravages. Once he gets his Blink Dagger, it's going to get all the worse for London Conspiracy. They've got two intelligence cores that are incredibly squishy, one of which is very dependent on mobility. You don't get a much better setup for a Tidehunter Ravage.
Yeah, and they are trying to use the fact that that Ravage is online to push in here. They're going to charge Madara, but he's the Met Carrier. Just as bad as it is to go on the Spirit Breaker, going on the Bristle is equally a suicide mission at this stage.
Yeah, I think they really wanted to try and catch the Bristleback actually in the tower there and force London Conspiracy to come through this point where the Tidehunter could then get the Ravage out on multiples, and then they would just go for the supports. But
that's a really good point.
Since London Conspiracy didn't actually make that play, they just backed up with Madara, and London Conspiracy were actually so far back, they say, okay, just a charge lost. Who really cares? Now we've taken control of the Tier 1 tower, and London Conspiracy can't actually contest it.
And they seem a little... confused here as to what they want to do. They've just completed their mech on Bristle. Normally, at this point, you've got Zeusalt, the mech, Queen of Pain starts to build her first item. This is when you really want to be at least finding pickoffs around the map, but they give up the tower. They weren't really split pushing. Skylark not even at the Tier 1 bottom, and Spartan just trying to get his levels mid. Feels like Yellow Submar1ne. Natural move is, if you don't want to make us use Ravage, we just keep on 5-manning. We'll take the Tier 1 mid, maybe even push for the Tier 2, and force you to either come to play defense and maybe die a couple of heroes to the Ravage, or just give up towers for free.
And I completely agree. That should be the tactic from Yellow Submar1ne, in which case London Conspiracy, the most obvious play is you go for the offensive move first. Oh. You actually go for like a 4 or 5-man smoke and strike first on them to force them into either a bad Ravage or no Ravage at all, potentially.
Well, on that note, Cap, here is the smoke. Queen of Pain showing herself mid, towers in deny range. They're heading towards the Roche pit. There was a line drawn towards the pit earlier by Yellow Submar1ne, but maybe just a misclick or they changed the call because they're heading bottom instead.
They gotta keep going. They gotta go fast, right? You don't want to lose that Tier 1 tower as you make this pincer maneuver. So London Conspiracy, this could be potentially the best fight, especially if they start out with a kill on the Wisp.
Oh, do they want the courier? Do they want the kills? They kind of hesitate.
God.
They get nothing. They show Madara. Are they coming in? They still go forward. Madara's going to be caught up first. He pops the mech, but it's really only on himself to start the fight. There's a weird relocate from PSM that moves the Shadow Fiend just a few inches back. Now the Ravage comes from Yes, and they manage to bring down two. They'll bristle back the mech carrier, as well as the Wyvern. The counter Ravage, though, he saw Spartan stolen it, and now the relocate is going to end and ends up bringing the sniper a bit farther back towards safety. What a terrible fight in the end for London Conspiracy. Four dead. It's about to be five unless Spartan can pull the juke of his life, and he can't. Charge and brought down an ultra kill for, of all heroes, the Tidehunter.
I mean, think of the Ouch. Way Yellow Submar1ne read that. Look at the way they set up their fights, right? They had Tidehunter here. The Wisp actually came forward. He was the first one, the farthest one back, and I got excited. Like, oh, if they kill the Wisp first, that's huge. The Wisp actually ran up here, right? Because they know London Conspiracy go for a contest around that Tier 1 tower area, it's a very easy Ravage. It's such a small area. You hit it on 5, most likely. So the most obvious play there is London Conspiracy are going to come in from behind to try and catch you out and utilize the bigger battlefield to, you know, make Ravage a little less effective. But that was a good read by Yellow Submar1ne. They moved the Wisp very far forward, and the Wisp pretty much made sure that no one dies in that fight, and obviously just completely wipe London Conspiracy, taking over the game.
And there was some real hesitation from LC. They see the courier. They all stopped. A couple of heroes turned like they were going to hit it. Then I think the call was made, no, we can ambush the whole team and win a fight. So they don't get the courier. Then the Bristleback breaks his smoke, and he turns around like he's going to back off. Then he runs in. They initiate on him first. They force out the mech. It only healed him, and it just wasn't a good enough way to start the fight for them. They really, like you said, need to be blowing up the Wisp. Maybe the Sniper, although at this point he's gone for the Sanj first, which was the increasingly popular build towards the end of 6.83, just because if you survive a Sniper, you get off an extra shrapnel or a headshot, and it can just change the fight. So I agree. I think it was a really nice positional play by Yes, and it was also just LC indecisive, giving them zero chance to take
You don't get this far ahead in the first, like, 20 minutes of the game without you doing good things, the enemy team doing really bad things. So it's definitely a big combination of the two.
And they are really far ahead. That is a 10K gold lead experience, about 10K as well. And frankly, I thought if there was a point where LC would win, it was early, where they could dominate the lanes, potentially very strong dual lanes. We talked about it. Bristleback Wyvern, as well as Queen of Pain Rubick as potential dual lanes with a Zeus going mid. They had lane dominators. They had heroes that were difficult to kill. They had counters to Spirit Breaker charge early. They did not dominate that lane stage. And you just go back to that first move Saw Spartan made. He could have gotten a kill mid. Also could have killed the Courier. That would have been a little bit – it was a little unlucky he didn't get the Courier kill, but a lot of wasted time early and – then just that one bad fight bottom. And ever since then, it's been all Yellow Submar1ne all the way.
Yeah, they're going for a three-man smoke up now, but this is not going to go well, I think, for London Conspiracy. Even if they did, like, catch the Sniper or maybe even, like, kill the Wisp or something like that, I just don't think it would have been worth their time, essentially. They're still going to be very far behind. It would have been essentially one of those smokes that you get a kill, but it's like, what do you get off of that? And it wouldn't have been anything. Meanwhile, Yellow Submar1ne are going to continue to take objectives.
I think they can just five-man, honestly. Yep. They're that tanky. They've got Sanji and Yasha on Sniper. They've got 4K on Barash, who is not bothering to spend it, by the way. I find that's just a sign of how far ahead they are. If this is a close game, you're not sitting on 4K when you already have Aegis as Shadow Fiend. But like, you know what? We'll take this tower. We'll take that tower. A little bit of that. A little bit of this. We'll have a sampler of everything on the LC menu. And it looks like maybe top is where they want to go next.
Yeah, he probably, like, I would assume he's going BKB as his next item. There's still a ton of magic damage. I don't think that Butterfly is particularly, like, strong straight after mech. If you are very far ahead, it's not worth it.
Do you think he's far enough ahead to just go, like, straight, say, Eye of Scotty or something this game?
I mean, that's...
Sanjin Yasha. We've seen a lot of Sanjin Yasha Shadow Fiends.
Yeah, I don't think you... personally, I would say you should... almost never invest into two SNYs. Mm-hmm. That's just my personal preference.
On one lineup, you mean?
Yeah, I think that basically is investing too much like early to mid-game focus. So I would say normally the SF should be focusing more on the late game while Sniper has to do what Sniper does, right? He just has to stat up as best as possible. SNY is like a must for him. Like the best thing that like Sniper can possibly go from SNY straight to Scotty. But, you know, 9 times out of 10, it's going to be SNY, BKB, then thinking about Scotty or maybe
something like a Maelstrom mixed in there, potentially, depending on the game.
Yeah.
But they're pretty much, I mean, this is like Mushi levels of cold saving, honestly, dude. He's got 5K.
I see no reason not to be spending your gold here.
Yeah, I guess Scotty could be his option. You've got
You know what he might want to go for?
Silver Sench.
Silver Edge.
Yeah,
versus Bristleback. We've seen a lot of teams doing this with Dragon. It seems like I saw like four or five games in a row where a Dragonite would be picked versus Bristle, and then he'd always go Silver Edge because Shadowblade is really good on the hero for initiation.
Yeah, and then the Sage is it's a very good stat item anyway, mm-hmm. so it's a very natural build-up. Hell, half the games when you have a Dragonite, I say Silver's Edge is a decent item pickup, even if there is no passives to remove, or even just having Shadowblade and potentially just a value Sage to build into Silver's Edge a little bit later.
And the best part is, BKB is the counter to this item, but Bristleback is too poor to afford one. So having the Silver Edge now means the Bristleback is very easily dealt with in these fights.
Absolutely. They do have some spam to be able to throw out there, so Yellow Submarine aren't going to have the easiest time going uphill at 20 minutes, but they'll be able to siege down this tower eventually, especially with the sniper, right?
They are trying to split push with Skylark, but he's getting charged, and I don't know if Fervian can solo kill him, but he's getting reinforcements now. The relocate comes in on demand. They're going to bash him back. Raise one. They don't even need raise two. And then right back to pushing, I imagine.
Yeah, that's a simple mistake, right? You actually cannot afford to ever. Oh, look at London Conspiracy. They're actually going to try and fight this one.
Oh, that could be a mistake. Ravage caught two. Submar1ne got the steal, but does he get it off? He's kept alive by the Embrace. I don't know if the Ravage will matter, even if he gets it off. He does, and it brings three kind of low, but Barash just walks in. He's still got the Aegis regardless. Submar1ne magically surviving, but it doesn't matter.
No.
Stolen Ravage, and they still get crushed.
That's two fights, right, that they've stolen Ravage, and it didn't matter at all. Yellow Submarine just crushed it so heavily. Man, this is getting endgame. Like, buybacks coming out at 20 minutes. Even if you do manage to survive, you've just crippled yourself so heavily that.
You know, it reminds me of, like, a football game where you hit, like, a Hail Mary touchdown pass, and you're like, oh, shit, we're still down 40 points. We're going to need five more of those or six more of those to get back in this one.
Yeah,
this
and I would still say Yellow Submarine have the advantage heavily when it comes to late game. I really felt like London Conspiracy would have, like, I felt they could have had a laning phase advantage. They definitely should have won fights 15 to 25 minutes if they didn't lose the laning phase so heavily. And then the mid game, you can end by probably, I would say, 40 minutes, right? And
yeah.
The biggest fear for me was actually Yellow Submarine just, like, turtle things out and you get a sniper in SF who are just able to take the late game over, potentially Tidehunter with, Refresher Ravage ready to go, and London Conspiracy just can't end the game fast enough. But it's the exact opposite. Like, Yellow Submarine have been in the driver's seat the whole entire game, and London Conspiracy are left with this very awkward situation where it's like, there's no way you win fights for the next 15, 20, 25 minutes. So you're the ones who actually want this game to go late, despite the fact that you do not have a late game lineup. It's basically because it's your only shot. I mean, it's literally impossible for them to win fights.
And the real issue is, this is a terrible lineup to be playing from behind against, because you're up against Wisp, Spirit Breaker. To some extent, the Sniper and Blink Tide can also get involved. Like, you've got a Shadow Fleeing who has a Silver Edge, so he can be anywhere, ganking at any time. They have no vision, really. Like, I mean, you look at these wards. There's just one city in the middle of the mid lane, one up on the high ground. If Yellow Submarine get a gem, I don't see LC leaving the base for more than a wave or two. And if they do, it's with five heroes.
Mm-hmm.
This is bad, man. This
Tidehunter, he's already building into that
straight
refresh.
Well, not even straight. He got a four staff along the way. Wow.
Yeah, he actually had quite a bit extra. Even the Wisp is looking like pretty wealthy. He's got a Glimmer Cape and a point booster. So.
Pretty wealthy. This Wisp is like Scrooge McDuck mm-hmm. right now. This is a baller Wisp.
The five man, this is like the end game smoke, right? If they find a pickoff, they go straight uphill.
Yeah, absolutely. They've got the items for it, the map control. And the buffer of just where the creep equilibrium is. Top lane is pushy a little bit. If they want to address that, they could go for a relocate, but then they wouldn't have it for the defensive save. So they may just hang out around the pit a bit longer.
Oh, real quickly, I want to go back. Guys, if you're ever facing up against a Spirit Breaker Wiz combination and you have a hero like Queen of Pain, you can't ever blink if you're split pushing, right? Because if you blink and there's a charge coming for you, You have to have that blink in order to be able to do the blink at the last half second before the charge hits you, and they've already set their relocate up.
Yeah.
That's your only hope of surviving, is you actually get enough distance away from the relocate, and the Spirit Breaker is pretty much the only one who hits you at that point. But this is just something that Skylark has to keep in mind
when he goes for these split pushes, and he has to split push.
The
right
thing
now.
Is,
there's
it's
no
just
option.
It's like very psychologically difficult because when you're this far behind, you're like, I gotta farm as much as possible, and I have to put as much pressure on the other lanes so that they don't push into high ground. But you're right, if you use that blink offensively, or well, not even offensively, just to farm, then you're food. Dale blinks in, and well, the Queen of Pain ult will hit him. Sniper gets last hit on the tower. Yellow Submarine, I think they want to wait for this next Roche and then break the base. And what do you know, Cap? This Roche is... It's feeling like Yellow Submarine just scripted this whole game. 25-9. Roche is going to respawn practically the second that Barash gets this haste rune. And then they're probably going to take the Aegis and go for the gusto. Push up on the high ground and look for their first lane of Rex.
Yeah, and if it was a late Roche on, they probably wouldn't care too much. It would be a little bit bad for them, right? But it wouldn't matter that much just because they know Bristleback isn't going to have a BKB no matter what. They forced him to buy back earlier, right? It's one of those buybacks that it's like, yeah, you managed to keep the game going a little bit later, but you're still going to be losing because you're in the same situation you always were. You do not have the BKB coming in, and it's essential against that Shadow Fiend Silver's Edge, which is going to take away that passive and makes you a very squishy hero. I mean, he's only sitting on 1,400 HP.
Well, Cap, this could be the fight. LC moving towards... No, never mind.
Can't even
that's what LC is
inside.
Thinking. They're like, all right, this is going to be our big moment, guys. We got this. Oh, shit.
I could see it all in my head. The Winter's Curse on 5. They're able to jump in the Queen of Pain, Sonic Wave, and Scream. He picks up the Roshan kill, grabs the Aegis, and... I don't even know what
and
happens
then,
from there. I actually still don't see a winning
scenario
at all.
Yeah. They'd have to steal Ravage, like somehow kill the Wisp instantly, steal the Aegis.
Somehow like Tidehunter whiffs like he gets his Blink Dagger pinged and he accidentally ravages before blinking and then Rubik steals it, so it's a zero man ravage to a fine band man ravage that you've stolen.
And the Wisp dies off the bat, and then probably somehow you have enough time to steal the Zeus ult as well, which is gonna require an Aghanim's that Spartan is simply not able to farm.
And then Cinderella's godmother comes in, and or godfairy, and grants you 3 magic wishes as well to help you win the team fight. That's pretty much everything that needed to happen for London Conspiracy.
Right, well, they've got exactly 0 of those things lined up, so time to get to work if you're LC. A whole network of wards getting dropped down outside this dire base, and then Fervine says, cut the bullshit. Let's go in and just win this one. Netherstrike onto Kaiser after the charge onto the Rubik. They'll get both. Zeus will buy back, and Yellow Submarine just don't care. They're going to drag LC down into the murky depths beneath. Another charge forward. That one is canceled by a bolt, but already the damage is done. They still haven't committed a Ravage. What do you do if you're LC?
I mean, Kaiser bought back and immediately popped his ultimate. Literally half a second later, Yellow Submarine looked like they didn't get hit by a single spell. They were all full HP. They're dropping a little bit lower, but they still have the Aegis on Barash, so this is guaranteed a lane. One lane of Rax and potentially 2. Yellow Submarine probably just go middle after this.
Oh, they have the Silver Edge. Madara's got to be careful about walking in. The second that Ravage hits him, he's just done for. But Barash isn't going to use it. He's just going to back off, raise the wave. They got the range Rax. They may want to wait until they have the mech cooldown to go again. Potentially just wait for that BKB Spirit Breaker as well. Because that's one thing we didn't discuss. There's not great solutions for this. You've got just the Wyvern ultimate as a potential way to deal with this charge.
Yeah, and you really don't want to use that ultimate on a Spirit Breaker who most likely, as he's charging forward, is going to be very much separated from his allies. Very little chance of you catching anyone else with
that ultimate.
And
even if they kill him, then you still have Ravage, Sniper, and Shadow Fiend waiting, and you're going to lose the fight anyway. So, yeah, it's... In that sense, it's like they have no counter for BKB charge. Well, let's see. This looks very, very bleak for LC. If they can win this fight, I'm going to completely 180 my viewpoint on the game because I'm just not seeing it right now. Oh, this could be kind of big.
If they win this fight, I don't understand
Dota. Don't say anything
Dota.
You're going to regret.
I will just say I don't understand Dota, and then people will be like, huh, Kev, you didn't understand Dota anyway.
Noobcaster.
BKB charged by Furby, and they're not able to interrupt this thing once again. The ultimate for the Wyvern was cooling down. Out comes the Ravage. Rubik will steal it, but then what? Where do we go from here? They have their Queen of Pain ultimate. This could be it. They've got the Aghanim's ult. She blinks it. Unloads. Cap, I think you might not understand Dota after all, my friend. PSM going to fall. It's 3 down, but they have both cores, and with that, it's a triple for Barash. The buyback on the Bristle and the Rubik. They're going to commit to this one. He's got an Aegis still. It will take a long time to bring the Shadow Fiend down. Sniper says, I'll see you later, Shadow Friend. They've got sentries. They'll bring him down once he turns with the auto-ticks. Almost getting the Wyvern.
Oh, no.
There's going
to
be a raise.
Had to run
There's going
to
be a raise.
He's going
to
get double raises potentially.
Oh, the jukes. He survives. He's toying with the Shadow Fiend. They'll get
The death animation. He gets him in the end.
Still, so worth it.
That was literally the dream. There is no better setup. You hit a five-man Winter's Curse into a five-man Ravage with a five-man Sonic Wave. It doesn't get better than that. Like, it literally doesn't. And yet, it still was not won by London Conspiracy. I do understand Dota.
Ultimately, they have to use two Bivex. It's like 1,000 gold swing their way. And when you lose a lane of Rex, you need like that sweet like 6,000 gold swing.
Yeah, I would say it's definitely still worth it for Yellow Submar1ne just to be able to get that melee Rex.
Also for them, it might be a little bit of a wake-up call. Okay, we're not quite as unstoppable as we think. We need to be a little more cautious about how we approach these fights. I imagine they're going to be a little more strategic in their next assault.
Yeah, we can't dive Fountain yet.
But soon.
But soon, especially with that refresher.
They have Sniper. This hero is the ultimate fountain camper.
Yeah, he really is.
Along with, I guess, Tinker's up there, just because you can constantly have your Ghost Scepter up or E-Blade and just zap them without having to commit too much towards the well.
Or the Aghanim's AoE laser, four rockets being thrown out.
That's the real dream.
Have you ever dealt with that in a pub?
LB? Yeah.
It's actually the most obnoxious thing ever to play against. When a team is turtling with that.
The thing is, it's not even that good. Like, you're not going to win with it, but you're just going to make – it's just like you're going to make other people unhappy, basically.
Oh, you know what I think is actually really legit?
What?
Is the Wraith King Aghanim's. Someone is going to run a support Wraith King that's able to get the Aghanim Scepter. My God. That Aghanim's is so insane.
Have we seen that hero once since the newest patch? I don't think so.
I don't think so at all.
I remember way back in the day when the old Complexity, which later became largely Team Liquid, they would run like their four staff Wraith King. Everyone was just blown away. Like, I thought Skeleton King was actually, I think he was Skeleton King back then.
Yep, he was.
Yeah, that was before he had to get a little makeover.
I actually brought up the old Complexity just the really? Other night when we were talking about the current Complexity, and I was saying that. Both teams actually back then, both teams were actually running basically the same style that teams just could never really have a good time countering. And Complexity actually proved that by running like a Furion with a Keeper of the Light Phantom Lancer, which naturally says split push, right? But sure enough, they still went back to the old style, which is a lot of mid-game team fight.
Yeah, that Keeper of the Light, I feel, is deceptively strong at that, especially if you can ever get the Ags farmed up. Mm-hmm. That thing's dirty.
All right, so next potentially endgame push for Yellow Submar1ne. This time around, they're going uphill without an Aegis, which means the spamming of London Conspiracy may actually be able to push them back. But before that happens, that Tier 3 tower is going to be taking a lot of damage or potentially even being taken out.
Yeah, they basically have the refresher here on Dale as well, if they want. I mean, they almost have it, and they're like, you know what? Let's just go for two lanes of Rex now. We don't need this thing, which is maybe a little actually, it is coming out on the courier, it looks like. So they'll probably want to wait another wave for this refresher. If they lose this fight before the refresher is delivered, that's the kind of faceball moment that the team could just tilt off of. But I'm talking about losing fights. And Madara is just losing all his health when he tries to walk in. The Silver's Edge means he can't get aggressive here without committing the BKB. And he doesn't want to do that until the Tide actually looks to Ravage.
Yeah, I would say the Yellow Submar1ne, all right, we're ready to go. We've got Refresher. You might as well just, like, jump in, blow the first Ravage just to get one.
BKB comes out from the Bristleback, and the engagement begins in earnest. Shadow Fiend laying into him, gets off the Requiem. Great Queen of Pain ult, but they need that Ravage steal. They're just waiting out these BKBs, and now they jump forward. Ravage connects. Queen of Pain BKB ending during the Ravage travel time, and a second celebratory Ravage just for the hell of it. Rubik stole it, died before he could really do anything. And well, that's it, Cap. London Conspiracy, wow. Not going to go 2-0 in their first two matches.
I'm not sure how much of that was Dota and how much of that was just some sort of like Heroes of the Storm battle arena. You just smash things together.
They never
in the
stopped.
Beginning,
like, no farming. No, there was like a couple Shadow Fiend stacks. And then let's just fight nonstop for 30 minutes.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun to watch for sure. But it also felt like it wasn't like very strategic in nature. And I think that was really the London Conspiracy's downfall ultimately, right? I mean, I felt like they had pretty good setup, but that the aggro tri-lane start out first blood. Like, why would you go for the first blood? And then the way this game started,
they try to commit to first blood. I believe they only had four heroes there as well. And then they go on the Spirit Breaker against a sniper.
Yeah.
And then they're like, indecisive about it as well. And so they give up first blood, but that's not the worst thing in the world because Tidehunter has to skill Gush in the offlane against the Queen of Pain. That's pretty bad in a 1v1 matchup. Still,
but then other fights after that, they would still target the Spirit Breaker, right? It was just like, you got to stop throwing lightning bolts on a hero that it only does maybe a fifth of his HP.
Yeah, and I feel like looking at the – a lot of it somewhat came down to just not making adjustments at the, and not being in the right place at the right time later on. Like, Rubick went for the gank mid. Then he tries to go for the courier. He ends up getting nothing out of that. That was a huge amount of wasted time. The dual lane offlane Bristle Wyvern actually did reasonably well, I felt like, but it didn't really shut down the sniper. They tried to make that one decisive move bottom where they sent four heroes in, but they didn't have their Bristle back there. And I don't know if they weren't really planning on fighting. It was more Yellow Submarine jumped them, but I feel like they didn't respect how strong Yellow Submarine's five-man would be once they got to it. And they ultimately just accelerated the point where they'd get to the five-man.
Who do you have for an MVP? I'm going to say PSM solely because I feel that
I would definitely
PSM,
agree.
His Wisp, whether it was the fault of London, like it's a mixture of both, right? The fault of London Conspiracy not targeting the Wisp maybe as much as they should have, but also that PSM just always managed to survive, kept everyone alive, really well done. And I feel that his play on the Wisp was pretty well
100%. He had the excellent relocate save earlier in the game. He, the one fight that they won convincingly with four heroes, that was all PSM and whatever.
Look at that face. That is not the face of a Wisp player.
That's the face of a little kid that just had his ice cream cone stolen at the beach. And he's like, Mommy! But, hey, he can make whatever face he wants as far as his team's concerned if he's going to play like that.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, Cap, no undefeated London Conspiracy. The dream is already dead. But they still are in a good position here. They have 3 points already. They win one game here. They have four. Then they're going to have to cobble some points together against the other teams in this group. Do you see Yellow Submarine 2-0-ing this, or do you think it's going to be a 1-1?
I going into this series, predicted a 1-1, seeing that first game and how surprisingly shaky London Conspiracy was. I'm not sure. I'm actually feeling like it's going to be a 2-0 now for Yellow Submarine.
Uh-oh. Well, London Conspiracy fans, you better hope they can pull it together. You heard it here from Cap. With that said, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll have game two of this two-game set. You're watching the Ti5 European qualifiers. We're live from the hub. We'll be back.